Yes, I did my MBBS at Madurai and I also did my MS, MCH, everything at Madurai. And I moved to Chennai only in 89. He was my teacher, Professor Namrajan at Madurai. I always salute him whenever I talk in anything in general surgery. We all know, see, we all have a clinical practice and it's based on knowledge and experience. And the knowledge seems to be ever expanding the way things are exploring the knowledge. We can't depend on textbooks, journals, and they all seem to be outdated. So now the most popular seems to be in the internet and use some search engines like Google Scholar or Medscape. That's how now we seem to be getting the current modalities of treatment. What was correct yesterday becomes wrong today, and so we combine the knowledge with the experience, and that's how the practice goes. Earlier, all the professors used to say, okay, my vast experience, mannitol is mandate, is all head injured. I mean, now if you say that, you'll be saying, sorry, there is no evidence for that, there are definitely indications. Like that, in every field it has come to say like that. We have evidence, we have expertise of experienced surgeons, and guidelines are formed in that. In all fields of medicine, including neurosurgery, you heard Dr. Singleton talking on guidelines like that. We have, based on that, we do practice, but then we evaluate the results, and again we get back evidence, we get more experience, and based on all these things, in any given patient, we have integrated clinical decision in management. Now, why guidelines? Now, a lot of situations, there is more than one form of treatment, especially now in head injury patients, there is no field, no part of the treatment which is revealed with controversy. Starting from positioning the patient, that they give mannitol, they give Lasix, they give prophylactic anticonvulsants, put the patient on ventilator, everything is revealed with controversies. So now we use guidelines, we have a consensus treatment. It becomes easy for us to make decisions. And we also, because we are following guidelines, we feel we are updated and we are giving modern treatment. And certainly it leads to a better outcome. And of course, in case of failures, we can always explain why, in spite of the efforts, we failed. Rather than say, okay, because of our treatment, patient failed, we can say, in spite of the treatment, the patient failed. So, if we take traumatic brain injury, the guidelines were formed way back in 1995-96, and it is gradually, by the efforts of the neurosurgeons and trauma surgeons, it has, the implementation has increased from, say for example, ICP monitoring was increased from 32% to almost to now 77 to 80% in US, ICP monitoring. And the use of steroids was brought down from earlier to 50% to brought down to almost 20 or even less than that. Like that, all these things have improved the outcome in severe head injury, which was more than 80%. Now it has been brought down to almost 16 to 20% by all these guideline adherence. Now we have guidelines in two ways. One is for the neurosurgeons, once the patient is in the hospital, the Brain Trauma Foundation guidelines. The other one is the National Institute of for Health and Clinical Excellence guidelines. See, the brain injury itself is a clinical diagnosis. We make a diagnosis of brain injury if the patient is not fully conscious, has got a low GCS, and it gives history of loss of consciousness, has got a post-traumatic amnesia, retrograde amnesia, then we say the patient has got a brain injury. Now, the guidelines, they give what to do in emergency room evaluation, how to resuscitate, whether to observe or whether to admit or to refer or to discharge, whether to do CT scan or not, when to do CT scan, when not to do CT scan, which hospital to send, whether you send the patient to Yes, a nearby good hospital, or you just, you have to send the patient to a dedicated neuro center. So it has been shown beyond doubt that it's better to send the patient to a dedicated neuro center, provided the hospital is ready to accept and has beds. So now in head injury, CT scan has become almost mandatory. It is done in all patients. Most of us, we think that head injury means CT scan is needed. So I just say when CT scan is not indicated. So that is all given in now in guidelines, in NICE guidelines. So patients with adult patients with only scalp injury, there's no brain injury, or in children with scalp injury of less than 5 cm, we don't need to do CT scan. Or in children, in adults of less than 65 years, who have got retrograde hemorrhages of less than 30 minutes, or patients who have improved in GCS at 2 hours, we don't need to do CT scan, especially if they don't have headache, they don't have vomiting, and that also they have specified, if it is the adult, if it is more than one vomiting, there is an indication for CT scan. Whereas in children, they vomit for nothing. So if it is more than four times, more than three times only, children CT scan is done. Like that, they have given, for each and everything, there are guidelines to follow. And they also given the timing and repetition of the CT scan. So if a patient is, for example, we had one patient who was received at in the afternoon 3:30 with good GCS. The CT scan had already been done. It shows a small external hematoma. The patient was fully conscious. And the patient was treated and said, okay, CT scan is it doesn't show any midline shift, so you may not be operated. But you know what happened? After a few hours, the patient became drowsy and became less responsive. And the CT scan shows that the hematoma has evolved to a large size and compressing the basals, the ventricles, the midline shift. This patient required a surgery and he did well. So now, guidelines for referral of the head injury patients. It's all given again in the NICE. ABC of resuscitation has to be done and has to be comprehensive before prior intimation is important. Again, as I said earlier, it is better to refer the patient to a dedicated neuro center rather than a non-dedicated or nearby hospital. Of course, cost factor becomes very important. There are no guidelines. It has to be individually decided by the practitioners and physicians. The Brain Trauma Foundation has formed a definite guidelines on the management of the severe head injury. It gives us what is the evidence for giving anticonvulsants, the antibiotics, to give the anti-edema measures, when to operate in EDH, SDH, all these things are clearly given in guidelines. Most of us, the practitioner, we find that the anticonvulsants are given prophylactically. That means a patient has got head injury, but he has not thrown any seizures. To give anticonvulsants in these patients, now there is a recommendation, level 2 recommendation, which says that in patients with severe head injury who have contusions or a depressed fracture or hematomas, we give anticonvulsants for first 1 week only, and then it stopped. The anticonvulsants is to be repeated, to be given, restarted only if there is evidence of seizure activity, because whether you continue anticonvulsants or not, the occurrence of a late or delayed post-traumatic epilepsy is not changed. So that is the current recommendation. Because we see patients with phenytoin hypersensitivity dying after a few days after severe head injury, in which probably it was not at all indicated. So the current evidence and the recommendation as per the guidance is to give only for first 1 week. Now again, mannitol. Mannitol is known for its good and bad effects, and of course in the research, Nainital research, there was a big scam in 1995. It was revealed only in 2005. A Brazilian neurosurgeon, Benjamin Cruz, he published trials on Nainital, high-dose Nainital therapy, and later he committed suicide. The reason was the whole study was a fraud one, it was a cooked one, and somehow it got into the literature. The same thing was being repeated by so many journals in so many journals, and then he couldn't. There was no other reason other than this for him to the feeling of guilt, and he committed suicide. Okay, that's by the way. Now, if you see the mannitol in head injury, there is no class one evidence. That means we know it's difficult to have a good quality randomized control there and giving mannitol, no mannitol. But there is good evidence. There's a level 2 recommendation. It says that definitely mannitol is effective for control of increased intracranial pressure at the doses of 0.25 to 1 gram per kilogram body weight. But it's very important that hypotension should be avoided. You see, when we give mannitol, we are causing volume depletion. The volume gradient, the theory was the brain is made dry in head injury, it's no more. We want to perfuse the brains, and so we have to increase the perfusion. That means we should have the volume. So mannitol is to be given only when the raised intracranial pressure situation exists. That means unless we measure the ICP intracranial pressure, then giving mannitol is not recommended. Of course, in dire situation, supposing a pupil is dilated on one side or the patient is now started decerebrating, there's a rapid drop in GCS, then the patient is to be referred to hospital, or the patient is already in the hospital, is to be taken up for investigations and evacuation of the hematomas. Before that, we can give mannitol without ICP monitoring. Otherwise, ICP monitoring has become very important as per the guidelines. We do ICP monitoring in most of the head injury patients as per the Bright Rama Foundation guidelines. So it's a very simple logic. We want to treat a patient with a diabetic rheuma without checking the blood sugar? Certainly not. Like that, if you want to treat a hypertensive crisis in a patient without checking the blood pressure, we don't. Supposing a diabetic rheuma, you do the blood sugar and check and give insulin and then recheck, and then the same way, if you want to treat ICP, increased ICP, which is the most important part of the head injury management, we have to measure the intracranial pressure and give treatment only when the pressure is going up beyond 20. So if you try to guess ICP by looking at pupils, heart rate, or even CT scan, then we'll be wrong. And we'll find that suddenly the patient deteriorates. The patient was okay, and then within a few minutes, he becomes a brain dead. So that means there is a lot of flaw in just a clinical monitoring. It's very important. I'm not saying clinical monitoring is very, very important to be correlated with ICP monitoring, but it's not just adequate. So we do this ventricular puncture, and even in a small narrow ventricles, and put the transducer, connect it to the extraventricular drainage catheter, and use this multimode monitor to measure the intracranial pressure. See this, see the CT.